Hello, everybody. How you doing tonight? You doing all right? Yeah. All right. Today we're going to be talking about the power of perspective of a promise. We're also going to be talking about how promise helps us become a legendary leader in that which we decide to become a leader in. I know that everyone here wants to be a leader that's standing on this stage someday. And my promise to you today and tonight is that I'm going to be delivering for you a very unique perspective as to how you can be that person that makes and keeps promises in your business, in your family life, in your real world. But the way that we have to do that is to consider the fact that all of us have a signature move, something that makes us stand out in this world that makes us unique. That's how we become a legendary leader. Unfortunately, so often we don't understand what our signature moves are. If I were to ask you, hey, what's your signature move? You'd be like, well, I don't know. I mean, I can get in a door, I can do this or that. But I want you to think, how does your signature move help you become a legendary leader? That's truly keeping your promise. So we're going to talk about the legends of stage that have incredible signature moves. If I were to say the name Michael Jackson, what is his signature move that you expect to see when he comes on stage? The moonwalk. And what do they say about you? What is yours? Because that is your promise to your audience. No matter how tired you are, no matter how many times you've banged on a door, you are going to deliver as a legendary performer every time if you keep your promise. So I want to show you guys what would happen if Michael Jackson, way back in 2000 and, I don't know, let's say 2000 and, let's say the 90s. Let's just go back to the 90s because that's when he was the biggest star at the time. 80s and 90s. You go to his concert. You're expecting to see the moonwalk. He shows up. He's tired. He's done too many performances recently. He does not want to deliver his signature move that night. It would still be a good performance because he's Michael Jackson. But it would not be what you expected. And since he's a promise maker and keeper, he will deliver that. But let's imagine he doesn't. One time. Thank you. All right. That is so tiring. I don't know how I even did that. That was pathetic if you think about it. You see, I'm a fat guy in a little coat. Fat guy in a little coat. That's how I feel up here trying to do Michael Jackson's signature move. That's not mine. But I can do mine. I'll show you it maybe. Sam wasn't even talking about it just a minute ago. That's what people expect to see from me when I take the stage. I want you to think about you as you are a legendary performer. What do they expect to see? What does your team expect out of you? How are you that legendary leader every single time you take your stage? Because you, my friends, can become legends of your industry, just like Michael Jackson was of his. I'm going to teach you a couple of steps here as to how you can figure out what yours is if you don't know. First, you can do step one, which is to identify what it is. Step two is to clarify. And step three is to magnify. Now, if you will figure this out in your mind as to how you can identify, clarify, and magnify all things between being a signature move master and being a promise maker and keeper, this is the formula that will change your life. Let's talk about step one as to how to figure it out. You see, if I were to say to you, hey, what's your signature move? A lot of you are like, I don't have a signature move like Michael Jackson. But you've probably used it your whole life. You just don't realize it. So instead of pinpointing it down to one thing, let me just give you an opportunity to think of it for a second in this terminology. Write down as many things as you are good at. Write down your skill set, your gifts, what comes natural to you. Because as you start to think about it and you see my word bank here, this is when I did mine, and this is what transforms everything for us. When we start to realize that we're helpful, we're giving, we might be romantic, focused, musician, leader, reader, you choose. Start writing them down. I give you permission to write hundreds of them down if you can get that far, and I applaud you if you can. But as you see on this word bank right here, we all have so much more that we're great at than we even realize. Because so often we're only thinking about where we lack. In essence, we already have it. And so once you've written down your top 20, top 30, top 50, maybe your 100, I want you to then go through and circle the ones that really identify. The ones that you go, you know, that's me. That's what I stand for. I am a service person. I'm an entertainer. I'm a worker. I'm an author, a journalist, an entrepreneur. Whatever yours is, those are some of mine. I'm just giving you examples because we're going to plow through this tonight. But as you start to really cut it down and refine it, after you've circled it, I want you to come up with your top 10, my friends. Because once you figure out your top 10, the next thing you know, you really have signature moves that make you unique. And are you utilizing them in every aspect of your business? Unfortunately, so often we don't use them because we're thinking, well, it's not that important. It's not that unique. Yes, it is. It's what makes you an effective leader. When we understand what our signature moves are, we become that effective leader we were always meant to be. That's how we can make and keep a promise to all those that we serve and all those that we're around. What I'm going to do now is I'd like to show you guys one of the, this is just the real quick run through. We did 100, we did the circle, top 10, that's it. Now let me show you an example of a guy who did it naturally without writing anything down. He thought to himself, I'm good at harmonica, I'm good at guitar, I'm good at singing, but I don't have the best singing voice. It doesn't matter, sing anyway. He was a poet. He had a lot to say politically. He's one of the great artists of all time. His name was Robert Zimmerman, but he decided that wasn't a good rock and roll name, so he changed it to Bob Dylan. I hope you remember Bob.
Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me. I'm not sleeping. Oh, they're in a place. I'm going to. Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me. In your jingle jangle morning, I come following you.
You're more like Bob Dylan. You're more like Michael Jackson's moonwalk than you realize. You are the legends of your industry. So step one is to identify what it is that makes you unique in your own mind. What happens next with step two is to clarify. Now we clarify by asking people that we trust, those that we truly will help us to refine what it is that allows us to keep a promise in every situation. First, we're going to ask our family, what is it that makes me unique? What do you believe makes me different? Then you would ask your team and your customers. You'd say, hey guys, what do you guys think makes me unique? What makes me an effective leader on this team? You'll hear some things you never thought you would hear, my friends. The last one is the ringer. And we heard this earlier by Ty Bennett, one of my favorite people. You see, when Ty was talking, he talked about asking those hard questions. Go ask a lost customer why you lost their business. It's not always going to come back to you have a lesser product or it's too expensive. Very often it could come down to the fact that we aren't using what it is that makes us unique. This story right now is going to help you understand that when we listen to what others say about what they see in us, it can transform our lives if we're willing to let it. There was a young man, his name was Reginald. He took piano lessons, he didn't like it, classical music, he was sick of it. And then one day he decided, when he was a little bit older than this picture, to enter a music contest. The judges told him some sobering news. You're a very good songwriter, you're a very good singer, you are not good at writing words. However, on the other side, they received an entry from another young man named Bernie. Bernie was not a songwriter, not a singer, but wrote beautiful poetry, lyrics that were awesome. What these two judges decided with these boys was to say, hey, you should just come together, try to figure out what the strengths and the weaknesses are of each other, and you can overlap your greatness. In this picture, you might recognize who I'm talking about, but Reginald Dwight eventually became Elton John, and Bernie Taupin is the guy whose lyrics we all know. I don't know if you guys remember this next song. This is an oldie but a goodie. This is Sir Elton John, if you want to sing along. Here we go. All right, everyone, put those hands together like this. We're going to get some energy in here. Here we go. Come on. Oh, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Oh, I remember when I was young, being Susan had so much fun. Heart in hand and skimming stones, hitting a good Chevy, a place of my own. But the biggest kick I ever got was down a bank of the crocodile ride. All the other kids were rocking round the car. We were hopping and bopping to the crocodile rock. Come on.
La 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 la.
Oh, that sounds good.
La 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 la.
One more time, come on.
La 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 la.
Wow, good job.
La 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 la. La 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 la.
Ladies and gentlemen, you did very well. Thank you very much. A little Elton John for you. How many of you sang? Say me. That was disturbing. Okay, good. I appreciate you guys singing along. You did awesome with that. But as you start to go through this process of clarity, as you start to really, really refine that which makes you unique and an effective leader, the next thing you get to do is to, step three, magnify that which makes you amazing. Once you understand what your signature moves are, that creates a legendary leader. How do we magnify that once we discover it? The first way is to make sure that we realize that this is our promise and we can own it, own what makes us awesome. We can then leverage it in every situation. It helps in sales. It helps in relationships. It helps in the ways that we interact with everyone. And then we can teach and share it. There are people that are not here today that are on your teams that you could take this process of identify, clarify, and magnify back to. And it could very well change their life. It could change your team. It could change your opportunity to really make a powerful impact on the world and all that you do. And so as we talk about our signature moves, I hope you've thought about what yours are, because you have them and you just need to use them, just like the legends of stage. The signature moves of becoming a legendary leader now becomes the promise. The promise to engage in an engagement experience with anyone everywhere we go. The first element of the promise is the audience. The audience is whoever it is that opens that door. It's that person that you're engaged with, and you have the opportunity to help them in their lives. The next is the family. We're not just talking the family at home, we're talking the family at work. If we don't see them as family, they're just coworkers, and then they're expendable. We want them to feel like family. And finally, the third element of the promise is the one. We'll get to who the one is, but let's start with the audience. We've already talked Michael Jackson. Think about your audience. Think as if you are a legendary performer each time you're on your stage in all that you do. Because when you have the opportunity to take your stage, you have the microphone in your hand, let's say. You know that you can either have the commercial be greater than the reality or the reality greater than the commercial. Is what you're advertising greater than the experience the customer receives? We've all been through this, where we go to a movie, and before the movie, there are all the movie trailers, a 3-minute snippet of the movie you should see. You watch that trailer, and you're like, we should go see that movie. And then you go to the movie, and it's nothing like the trailer. That's not how we want our business to be. We want every interaction and engagement to be greater in the reality than the commercial. And this was true when I got onto a shuttle here at the airport in Salt Lake City a little while back. You see, I'd been on a trip for about 2 weeks. I was exhausted. I sat on the shuttle, and does anyone know what the promise of the airport parking shuttle is? It's very simple. It's a very simple commercial. We'll get you to a car, or we'll get you back to the airport. That's their whole promise, right? It's not that difficult. But I got on this shuttle this day, and I did not realize I was about to be engaged in an experience I never could have imagined. I sat down on that seat next to other weary travelers. All of a sudden, the door closes, and we hear over the intercom,
"Well, hello, everybody. Welcome home to Salt Lake City. What you didn't realize is you have just entered the party bus. Now, if you want to get back to your car and if you want to get home tonight, I need everyone to say, yeehaw!"
Yeah, it was one guy. Thank you. No, the truth is, none of us said it. I don't know if you've ever been in an experience like this where you're trying to get everyone into it. You're trying to engage them. They're not coming along. This incredible shuttle driver, she was not deterred by our non-participation, because before she woke up, and before she got up and came to work, I'm sure she was like, you know what? I promised myself, no matter who plays along or who doesn't, because they're trapped with me for 5 minutes, I'm going to have a party with them. And so we didn't realize we were now stuck with this person, but she was not about to give in. And so she did not start the shuttle. She just sat there and said, "Well, I guess you don't want to go home. So if you want to go home tonight, I need you to say yeehaw." And I went, I was like, yeehaw. And I'm a motivational speaker. I was like, shut up, yeehaw. You know, I knew what she was doing, but I didn't want to play. But because I said yeehaw, she said, all right. She put it into drive. Now she's having her own party. She's just laughing and talking to herself, telling herself jokes that nobody's laughing at. You know, she's like, and then the turtle went in the garden and the 3 snails climbed on his back. And when they got on his back, he said it happened so fast. And we're like, get us to our car. And so she's driving, having a party. As we came up to the first stop, the commercial or promise of the shuttle driver is simply to open the door for the person standing there waiting. Not for this shuttle driver, however. She made a greater promise to herself. She opened the door, threw it into park, ran down the stairs, grabbed the bags of the waiting passenger, threw them onto the shuttle, ran back up as the confused customer walked on the shuttle. As the little shuttle driver ran back up, she said to us,
"Hey, everybody, how do we welcome our new friend?"
And we said, "Yeehaw!" Now she's created an engagement experience. We did not see this coming. We were exhausted and tired, but she gave us the energy to make it so that we could create something unique. Confused pastors, like, what's going on? We're like, she's telling all these weird jokes. Listen, this is hilarious. Second stop, third stop, fourth stop. By now, I'm high-fiving strangers, fist bumping, chest bumping. It was the craziest shuttle experience of my life. I'm now lamenting that I parked at stop six. Have you ever lamented parking so close? Never. But in this moment, I did. And when my stop came up, I said, "Hey, what's your name?" And I walked up and I took a picture of her. She said, "TJ." I said, "TJ, you are the world's best airport shuttle driver." To which she obviously replied, "Well, yeehaw!" Yeah. But I want you to think about, in what ways are you like TJ the shuttle driver? Because there are experiences that you have every day with your audience. You never know how they're going to react to you. You never know what's behind that door. But are you going to give 100% in every engagement with every audience? That's keeping the promise. And think about TJ the shuttle driver the next time you're like, these people don't want to play along. Because when we make a promise, it's the highest level of engagement we commit to in any experience. It's greater than a goal, greater than a commitment. It is a promise. If I were to say, "Hey, I set a goal to pick you up. I'll be there at 5. It's not strong enough. It needs to be a promise. "Hey, I set a goal to be faithful to you." It needs to be a promise. Why set a goal when we can make a promise? I'm not saying goals aren't important. Goals are essential. But goals are particulars where promises are proclamations. What are yours? Because when we really define for ourselves through identify, clarify, magnify what it is that is our promise as legendary leaders with our signature moves, that's when we become the great promise makers and the keepers. And so, why set a goal when you can make a promise? Tonight, I hope that you'll say to yourself, "I've made some promises now that I will never let go of." What is your promise? My promise to my audience is what? What might it be? Write it down if you need. But this could transform your business forever. As we move to the next element of the promise itself, the engagement experience, we've talked to audience. Let's now talk about the family. Now, when I say family, you know, in corporate America, when I speak at different events, a lot of people don't look at each other as family. They're just coworkers and so forth. But I want you to think, who is your family? Is it your team, your crew, your group, your community? Do you think of them as family? Or do you just think of them as somebody that's completely opposite of you? Because most likely they are. All they have is different signature moves that are valuable that can be utilized in your business and life as well if you'll allow them to. You see, I perform in spaces like this all the time with audiences that don't seem like they're excited to have me there. And I'm not going to pick on anyone in particular, but I want you to consider for a moment the fact that you guys do the selling at the door. You also make promises to those people about your team that's coming behind to get things set up, don't you? A lot of you do. And I'm talking, when I do an audience like a group of accountants, for example, for me, that's a hard audience. I'll tell you why. IT guys, engineers, here's why. They laugh inside their body. They're not fun for me as a performer. They're the kind of person that when you meet them, you're like, "Hey," because I'm a sales guy, "Hey, how you doing?" They're like, you know, that's their thing. They're like, "Don't touch me," you know, and I understand. They're different than me. Okay. But when I perform for those types of audiences, I have to really warm them up. I have to let them realize that we're just going to have fun. We can pick on each other's talents and strengths and gifts because they have certain things I don't have. I have things they don't have. And so this is the song I usually start with those audiences just to warm them up. "Hello, darkness, my old friend. I did a corporate show again. Some crowds make me want to start drinking.
white accountant silently thinking, never laughing, clapping, only internally when I sing. And I don't like the sound of silence. And I can't stand those IT guys and engineers with brains this size. Can they cut a showman any slack? Don't they know they gotta give some love back? And if they happen by chance to get a wife, her poor life, she'd only hear the sound of silence.
On my head, they usually are very afraid now. But they usually clap too. There you go. All right. Yeah. Now, some might think that's offensive, but the truth is this, my friends. We are completely the opposite often than the people we work with. And that can be difficult to deal with them. Imagine them dealing with us. Because we have extraordinary signature moves in the eyes of the awards and so forth. But there is always a team or a family, if you will, that makes it all happen. And without them, we don't really have much success. And so how can we make sure that they feel a part of a family with what you're creating, because you get the accolades, you're under the lights, you have the microphone? How can you help them utilize their signature moves? That's them keeping their promise and you keeping yours to them. Now, when it comes to being a family person, I do have a family. And I'm very blessed with, people are surprised to hear that I actually did get married. I have a family, and here's my little family. Actually, I rented these people for this picture. I don't know. But I want you to think about your family. Who's your family? What's your definition of family? I love being from Utah because it's so interesting, the signature moves of Utah. To me, it's hilarious. Wherever I perform and speak throughout the country, I can go anywhere and be like, I'm from Utah. So you must be assuming that I'm a skier. Yeah. And then I say, I'm just kidding. I don't ski. But my wives do. And that gets them. That gets them. Like, oh, man. Oh, man. I'm just kidding. They don't have skis. But the, oh. And then I say, all wives matter. And I lose everybody. But here's what here's what we need to remember. Wherever we go, there will be a signature move of that thing from where we are from, our business, everything. And so, can we change the perception? Oh yeah, just by the way that we are. It totally can work. But my friends, when my kids say to me, Daddy, let's do the dinosaur, I have a signature move, my friends. Sam Taggart even said it before I came on the stage. Do you still do the raptor thing? Oh, heck yes. I found out when I was in high school that I could do this. The Jurassic Park Velociraptor. And when the kids were little and they would say, Daddy, do the dinosaur. Do the dinosaur. They want to be scared. If I'm tired because I've had a long day of knocking doors, I might be like, let's do this one. I love you, you love me. That's not right. You see, how can we give 100% to our audience and not 100% to our family at home? Because we do that a lot. We're dead tired by the time we come back. And so when your kids say to you, either if you have them now or someday, if they say, Daddy, do the dinosaur, I hope you'll go for it. I hope you'll make a promise to yourself that if they ever request it, you will scare them. You will go 100% with Daddy Dinosaur. Are you sure you want the raptor? Yeah, Daddy, do it. The kitchen scene, Velociraptor, Jurassic Park. Yeah, Daddy. And I'm all, I'm chasing them around. And they're like, Daddy, no. And I'm like, you asked for it. And I chase him up the stairs. And then I go, okay, go to bed. Good night. For some reason, they don't sleep, you know. They're just up there like,
What's under the bed, kids?
It's fun to be that kind of dad. Question for you is this, although some of you are now very disturbed. What a shame if I hide that from my family because I'm tired. Right? They think I'm awesome, and they will until they're teenagers. Now when the prom date shows up, I'll be like, oh yeah? It's gonna be weird, man. I feel bad. What's your promise to your family? I'll tell you one thing. When you have kids, how many of you have kids? Let's see, raise a hand. Okay. How many of you someday want to have kids if you don't already? How many of you know people with kids? Let's see. Okay. Here's the thing. I've been running around the world making money, speaking, performing, making crowds laugh and think for a while now. It's been cool. It was a couple years ago I came home after being gone for a little bit too long. I used to do cruise ships, and I came home and I opened the door. After setting this goal on the plane that I would be a happy dad, I'd be a happy dad, because we had 4 kids in 5 years. So the kids were just like, you know, like all time, like, change my diaper, you know, it was literally just crazy. And I was like, I'm going to be a happy dad. My goal was to be a happy dad. And I opened the door after being gone for 2 weeks. And I go, kids. And they ran under my arm and said, Mommy. She'd been gone 30 minutes to get me at the airport. I'd been gone 2 weeks. I said, what's wrong with the kids? Don't they like me? What's their problem? You know, they're like 3 and 4 years old. My wife looked at me and she said, honey, we're thrilled to have you home. But now that you're home, we'd appreciate if you could be here with us. What do you mean? She said, you know, when you're here, you're on this. I said, well, yeah, I'm running my business. I got to answer questions and take calls. She said, yeah, but when you're home, be present. My friends, you're important people. You run businesses, but be present. I asked my wife, what could I do to make it so the kids like me? She said, try a one-on-one day. Like, just take your son to a play place at McDonald's for some health food. So we did. We're starting to drive, and I took my boy who's in front of my shoulder. His name is Romney, a strong Utah name. And he was 3 years old at the time. We hadn't gotten along very well. But as we were driving, I look in the rearview mirror, and he's like, I said, why are you so happy, buddy? He said, I like it when you're nice, Daddy, not mean, Daddy. I said, when am I mean, Daddy? He said, just not right now. You guys, I had never taken the time to just be with each kid. It's embarrassing to say that, but there's a reason that I'm sharing this message with you guys right now. Because when we went into that play place and we took a little quick selfie, and then all of a sudden, he said, can I go up there? I said, yeah. He ran up those steps to the top of the slide. And he goes, Daddy, Daddy. And I go, yeah. And he goes, zoop. Then he goes back up. And he's like, Daddy, Daddy. And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, zoop. And he goes up. And then he goes, Daddy, Daddy. And I'm like,
I've had enough.
No. That's what I was thinking. I didn't realize that this was a miracle in front of me that I would never get back. And instead, because I became bored, my hand went in my pocket, pulls out my phone, and I go and start doing business. I ended up on Facebook. That's the easiest place for me back then, Facebook. And I'm looking at people's lives, and I'm jealous of where they've been, the food they've eaten. And I started to post that I was at a daddy Sunday with my boy. And I posted the picture, and as I was pressing post, I realized I'm a hypocrite. Like, I'm a liar. And I deleted the post. And then I held down the Facebook app. And it started to do this little dance. And it had a little X in the corner. And I pressed X. And it said, are you sure? Are you positive? Yes. Come on, man. Don't leave me. I pressed delete, and the app was gone. And I looked up, and my boy was at the top of the stairs of the slide. And he saw that I was looking at him. And he zips down the slide, and he runs towards me, and he goes, "Can we play?" Yeah. Like, what am I doing? Even in these moments with family, am I present? My friends, how are we present with those that we will never get to see at this age again? I hope that you're considering it for yourselves. Because as much, if you want to take a picture of this, I love this. As quickly as this phone can connect us and you to the world, it can just as quickly disconnect you from your family. You have to run a business, I understand. But please set boundaries. That is a promise. A promise to your family to be the kind of person that they can count on, that they know is with them there now. And so when my kids say to me, "Daddy, what do these lyrics mean to this Lady Gaga song?" I say, "I don't know if I can tell you. But I do have a certain skill set that allows me to make it so that you can enjoy that song." And so I'm going to show you how I utilize my signature move, and I'm a legendary leader in my own home. I'm going to change a Lady Gaga song, and you're never going to hear it the same. I apologize, but I want you to know this. The kids love it. Sir, my friends, ask yourselves, tell yourselves, my promise to my home family is what? I know for me it's to be present, it's to be 100%, it's to go all in, and it's to disconnect when it's time. My promise to my work family is that I will trust their incredible signature moves. And I promise that they can utilize what makes them extraordinary and effective leaders. As you're thinking about what your promise is, we've talked about audience, we've talked about family. Let's close it out with the one. What is your promise to yourself? We make New Year's resolutions, and if you go to a gym parking lot right now, you can't even get a spot. Just wait till February. But my friends, what is your promise to you? Because if we break a promise to your audience, you lose the work. If you break a promise to your home family, you might get kicked out. But what about the promise to yourself? Years ago, I was offered the deal of a lifetime in Las Vegas to be a headliner in a show there. I was very excited to have my own show on the Strip. That was the lifelong dream. And as I'm sitting across from a hotel billionaire, he told me what he expected, and it was that they would write everything I would perform, and they would change my family-friendly show. It would be appropriate for the promise they made to their audience. But I had a promise to myself that I would not bend my own promise. Does that make sense? And in that moment, I had to make a decision. Do I become famous and have my name on billboards and taxis? And make it so that my family has security for life? Or do I keep a promise to myself that I would allow integrity in my character, my legacy as a legendary leader to live on? Ladies and gentlemen, I think you know what I decided to do. That's why you've never heard of me before. And I'm okay with that. I ask you, what is your promise to yourself? Because when I was a kid, I found out that I have these signature moves, the raptor, the singing, so forth and so forth. However, I went to the dentist, and this is when I realized I had something unique. I was 5 years old. I sat in the chair. The dentist said, open wide, and I could. Pretty good. He said, wow, I can use both hands, you know. And he started to work on me. He said, you're so lucky you have such a big mouth. I said, I don't feel very lucky. And he's like, wow, you can respond in complete sentences. It was incredible. The dentist then, he said to me, you're a funny kid. And I realized it was okay to be myself around him. And I realized I could do the sounds of the dentist's office while he worked on me. So I started to mess around with him, you know, doing those sounds. He's like, is this thing on? I'm like, I don't know. It's stuck on my tongue. It was incredible. He said, don't do that anymore, but that's amazing. I found out early on I could do voices, and it made people laugh. Mickey, Donald, Goofy, you know those voices.
Oh, boy. Hi, everybody. Mickey Mouse here. Oh, right.
Where's Goofy? Oh, where's everybody? Oh, where's Donald? You know, that kind of stuff. I found out I could sing like anybody, the Chipmunks.
Christmas, Christmas time is near, time for toys and time for toys.
And that freaks people out. But here's the thing. We need to share that which is what we are. My promise to myself is that I will share it with you, even though it's weird, even though it's a little different. It's okay. And so as you're thinking about what your promise is to yourself, I also want to give you guys something because I'm here tonight and my time is coming to an end. If you'll take out your phones and take a picture of the screen, that would be amazing. I just want you to text to 22828, the letters J, H, and E. Here's what you'll get. You'll get a full video of a downloadable video of my shows around the world. You'll get my ebook of signature moves, how to stand out in a sit-down world. I'm not selling anything on this, you guys. This is a gift to you for being at D2DCon. And so I appreciate that if you guys want to join me, you'll get some blogs and ideas about funny things, watching with your, if you even want to watch with your customers, that would be cool. Watch it with your team and the family at work. Maybe someone in your family you haven't connected with in a while. Laugh with me for a minute. Let me help you keep a promise to your family and your loved ones. I hope you'll join me on this. This is just my little gift to you that I can keep a promise to you guys. And I appreciate so much that I would be invited to be here tonight to share with you the promise, the engagement experience, how to become a legendary leader, and how to utilize that which makes you unique in all that you do. I have a few more voices that I want to close with before I pass out up here. I'm thinking some of these songs you might know, some of these artists. Do you guys remember this song? REO Speedwagon. The signature move of this artist was to overemphasize the letter R. Sing it if you know it. Help me out.
I can't fight this feeling any longer, yet I'm still afraid to let it flow. What started out as friendship has grown stronger. I only wish I had the strength to let it show.
Alright, if you know it, help me out.
And I can't fight this feeling anymore. Fighting for, and if I have to crawl upon the floor, come a crashing through your door, maybe I can't find this feeling anymore.
I love REO Speedwagon. That's a good one. How about this one? Let's do another one. How about Ricky Martin? Do you guys remember this guy? Come on. Lots of signature moves.
Into new sensations, new kiss in the candlelight. She's got a new addiction for every day and night. She'll make you take your clothes off and go dancing in the rain. She'll make you live a crazy life. She'll take away your pain like a bullet to your brain.
All right, you guys, I hope you'll consider your signature moves, that which makes you unique, an effective leader, and what your promise is to share it always. Utilize your voice, because it's amazing. Thank you for letting me be here. Let me close with this song right here. Louis Armstrong, I hope you remember him.
I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, oh yes, I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They learn much more than I ever know. Yes, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Oh yeah, Baba Jubadu. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Oh, yeah.
Thank you for making it a wonderful world, you guys. God bless you. I'm Jason Hewlett.
Let's give it up.
Thank you
so much.
Let's
give it up for Jason Hewlett. Let's give it up for Jason Hewlett. That was awesome. That was awesome. Hey. Hey! Yeah, rap! Yeah! I love it! I love it! Oh, man. No, the ability, in my mind, the ability to go from like one voice to another voice to another voice, I think we should recruit him. He'd probably be pretty good at this. No, but I really appreciate that. And talking to all these speakers as we kind of crafted this whole event, I said, how do we bring people in that can inspire us to be not only better salespeople, but better fathers, better father, like husbands, better stewards over our money, better people overall. So I really just a big thanks to Jason. That was awesome. To wrap up the night, couple items I wanted to go over real quick. I wanted to thank our sponsors one more time. This event couldn't happen without them, guys. It's truly what made this event happen. So make sure to go check out the sponsors. The VIP dinner, we have a couple extra tickets. So Trey talked about this. We want to invite those that really want to take their game to another next level, rub shoulders with the best. The Golden Door winners are going to be there. It's at the Marriott right across the street tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. If you just want to go upgrade your ticket, because obviously you guys all have general admin already, you can do so. We'll have a nice stay, casino night, a hypnotist that's like an entertainer there, and a really, really great place to rub shoulders with the best. So I invite you guys right now to go upgrade your ticket if you haven't. It's kind of first come, first serve, so we do have a few of those left. Next slide. I don't have the clicker. Here's the gold sponsors. Make sure to go check out the booths. Just so you guys know, I didn't talk about this much. Every booth was given tickets for a giveaway. Do you guys know that? Okay. So the booths all have a ticket for raffles. Some of you guys saw us give away something cool. Tomorrow and Saturday are the real giveaways. To tease you for a second, we have, for example, Epic is giving away a freaking trip to Bear Lake and snowmobile experience, everything paid. They're giving away those massive paddle boards, giving them away. We've got people giving away a full day or full week trip to Mexico or a vacation away. We're giving away iPads, Segways, Traeger grills tomorrow. Some amazing things. So make sure to get your tickets and raffles. What? Oh, I forgot about that. Are we doing that today or tomorrow? Okay, so who's playing tomorrow night? Do you guys know? Lakers and Jazz, and we got really good Jazz tickets. Uh-oh, four seats. We'll give two and two. So anybody that doesn't upgrade their ticket may have a chance to win Jazz tickets tomorrow. So make sure you're here. We've got some cool prizes. So we'll give those away first thing in the morning so you can kind of prepare your night. Let's put up the silver sponsors. Next slide. And we've got, just check these guys out. Honestly, I personally have a relationship with most of these people. And it's been so cool to see how excited they get seeing you guys. Like, often they go to these conferences, and they're like, never before do we have such a cool crowd. Like, of just, like, young hustlers, hungry, willing to learn. And it's fun to watch and see you guys. Next slide. Okay, the agenda for tomorrow. It starts 9 a.m. sharp is when somebody's actually speaking. So make sure you're here in your seats. I would say get here around 8:30. Because these seats will fill up. Because tomorrow we have Chad Hymas on the agenda. We have, guys, I got to do a podcast. I haven't released this yet. I literally was crying on the podcast with Chad. He was the youngest individual to ever be inducted into the Speaker Hall of Fame, to put things into perspective. Like, phenomenal, phenomenal keynote. He speaks over 200 times a year. He's spoken in 89 countries. And he's a quadriplegic, and he travels by himself. Figure that. How do you travel to different countries, and you can't even move your arms and legs? Like, it's mind-blowing, his story. These are the workshops for tomorrow. We do have a couple little changes. Those will update on the app. But for the most part, just so you kind of prepare yourself, because you can't make them all. It'll all be recorded, though, so if you missed one that you wanted to see and didn't get to see it, it'll be in the university, but just so you have it, there's the agenda if you haven't downloaded the Tiled app. Next slide. Okay, just really to wrap up, thank you guys so much for coming. Like, it's so cool to see everybody in here. I just want to appreciate you guys and honor you guys as a tribe. Like, I really put a lot on the line, and a lot of these people have put a lot of work into this. I want to thank not only my mom, my dad's here, my wife, my brother, my sisters, like all these people, the support team that we have is so cool. Like, it was a lot of helping hands. So I want to thank those that have helped and put this together and those that have helped put this on, like the vendors and you guys for being here and bringing so much energy. So we'll see you guys tomorrow, and let's go have a big day tomorrow.